A very good morning to all of you. I welcome you all to the ICANN initiative, the Hindu and Indian Express analysis. So today we will be covering the newspapers of Monday and Tuesday. So today, for the first time, I will not be discussing any personality of the day or story of the day. I rather have a very important issue that I want to discuss with you all. So for the past couple of days, I've been seeing in the comment section that somebody by name Shreyans Jain is trying to provide the notes of all the ICANN videos and is creating a separate Telegram channel, and he is giving those notes for payment. So first of all, let me tell you the reason behind why I started this video lectures. First of all, I wanted it to be kept free of cost to all of you so that everybody can access from wherever you are. So by making it for payment, the articles, by giving it for payment, no matter how meager the payment is, it defeats the whole purpose. So it would have been very easy for us also for me to just read the newspaper and make a PDF notes and then just give it to you. It would have been very easier, but making the video takes a lot of time and effort, but I still insisted that I will do the video. Reason being that when you are watching a video, first of all, your auditory part of the brain is getting activated. You are listening to something very carefully, and then you are also making notes. So this whole, these two process together, it will lead to registering those things in your memory for a long term. You will remember, you will retain, and you will also recollect at the right time in your exam. But what happens when somebody is giving you notes is that in the initial period, you will feel that, okay, why to watch the video? We are already getting notes. I've already made the payment. So you will just end up reading those notes. So in this case, what happens is, each of you are at a different level of your preparation. So your perspectives about something is very different from some other person's perspective about the same thing. You might be able to think in a multi-perspective manner, but the other person may not be able to. So when you are listening to the audio, even when you're listening to the video, your perspectives may be entirely different, and it might trigger your thought process. But when somebody is giving you notes and you're just reading those notes, that limits those perspectives from opening up in your brain. Had that been the case, why any of the toppers before, UPSC toppers, have never told read that notes or read this notes and you will be able to clear the exam? Why is everybody emphasizing on the textbooks and the authentic original sources to be referred to? Because that always has the advantage of giving you fresh perspectives each time you read them. So that is one thing. And second is, after some days, you will feel that there is no need to read the notes also, because notes are either way coming to you in the Telegram channel or through your mail, and you are accumulating those notes in a folder on your laptop. So you feel, okay, one fine day I will read all these notes and you will write them in the exam. But trust me, that is not going to happen. You will never end up revising. And those people who are doing this, they are such category of people who just accumulate notes, keep it, thinking that they will read it one fine day, and they will never do it. And if Shreyans is really concerned about all people, then I don't mind if he shares free notes, making all the notes of the whatever I discuss. Let him make notes and share it free of cost with everybody. I will not have any problem. But making it for payment defeats the very purpose why I have started this initiative. So whatever action is to be taken against him will be taken. That's a different thing. But this is very unethical and immoral, to say the least. And it's very disgusting and a cheap attitude to do such things also. So don't fall prey to all these things. Adopt a path which you feel is good, and also you are aiming to become civil servants, and it's not important to be civil servants, it's important to be a good civil servant. So it is important to be an ethical civil servant. So that's what you precisely have to be. So choose your or make your decision wisely, and if I see this continue in further, then I might take a call to even stop this initiative. So now with this, we will start with the first topic of the day, because we are covering 2 days newspaper. We have so many things to cover. So first, we'll be discussing about the lone wolf attacks. So the recent news is related to Reading. So Reading is a place or a town which is near to London. So in Reading, there was a knife attack on people. So where 3 people were killed and other 3 were injured. So this is an example of the latest lone wolf attack that has happened in the United Kingdom. So with context, we will see what is the emerging trend. The emer Earlier, what used to happen is the terrorist attacks were coordinated terrorist attacks. Okay, so in this, there was an attack that was fixed, namely, for instance, a religious place or some club or mall, so or railway stations where more people gather, and so that there could be more loss of lives. So these coordinated terror attacks were there before. And when these attacks are being planned, then even the intelligence agencies could detect the planning of these attacks because they were coordinated. So all the weapons and everything had to be planned accordingly. So in this case, the intelligence agencies were also able to detect and some of these attacks and even prevent them from happening. But now what is happening is there has been this emergence of lone wolf attacks. So these lone wolf attacks, what happens here, the attacker just either stabs knife into some random people or he just runs over the people with his vehicle. So this is the modus that is adopted now by the lone wolf attackers. And because these are lone wolf, anybody can just carry a knife and then stab into any random person on the road. So it is very difficult for the intelligence agencies to be able to detect these lone wolf attacks. So this is the change in the trend when we talk about the terror attacks in the recent times. So now we have to understand why is there this changing trend. So first, when the terrorist organizations like ISIS, it had controlled over almost Iraq and Syria, but now its control is shrinking in the wake of these counter attacks on these people. So what the Islamic State has now urged its supporters to do is that you stab people or run over them and carry out these lone wolf attacks and then declare allegiance to the caliph or then declare allegiance to the ISIS. So this is more easier. It does not require so much of sophisticated planning, nor does it require very sophisticated technology. In fact, just a vehicle to ram over people or just a small knife to stab people. So these are low technology lone wolf attacks. So it doesn't require sophisticated planning nor sophisticated weapons and technology. So this is very easy to be done because the control of these terrorist organizations had is also now decreasing. So this is why now this trend is emerging. So therefore, these lone wolf attacks, even today, they continue to pose a security challenge to the people and to the government in various countries. So what we have to what should be our way forward. First of all, it has to be a multi-pronged approach. So it has to be a multi-pronged approach. It should focus on de-radicalization. Youth, they have been brainwashed, they have been radicalized, and they have been made to carry out these attacks. So they will have to be counseled back to tell what the importance or meaning of the true meaning of religion is, and they need to be de-radicalized. And second thing is we need to have more human intelligence. Human intelligence means where we have these human beings who can live with the people in the society and then they can give information. So this intelligence agency based collection of data by using technology, that will not be much relevant, but rather human intelligence, where human beings can gather data by being with our fellow human beings as common people in the society, that is going to be more important. Next is community leaders. So community leaders and the religious leaders, they become very important. So if they give sermons to the people who belong to that particular community or religion that taking the path of violence is bad, then that will have a lot of weight that it carries among the people. So using roping in these community leaders and religious leaders for de-radicalization and counseling programs is very important. So these are the important steps that we need to take as a way forward. So this was about the lone wolf attacks, the changing nature of the terrorist attacks, and why is there this changing nature and what we have to do to tackle this. Now we'll go to the next topic, which is tackling COVID-19. So if you are given a case study that if you are a district collector of a particular district, what all steps you would have taken to tackle COVID-19. So this particular case study also we have already discussed in detail as part of a question and answer. So in this, there are some additional steps which as a district collector you can take, which can be mentioned in your case studies. The first important thing is a voluntary action. So COVID is a kind of disease where it's a crisis where a lot of people need to come out as volunteers and they need to help the communities or people who are suffering from this. So in this context, the National Service Scheme, which functions under the Ministry of Youth Affairs, and NCC, the National Cadet Corps, which functions under the Defense Ministry, these can be involved. The NSS involves the college students and NCC involves the school students. So they can be mobilized. When young persons are mobilized, they can go from house to house and they can spread awareness. So by this, the youth can also be mobilized voluntarily for action against COVID. Also because they belong to the youth category and the risk that these carry of serious illness is also very low. So that is why it would be safe to rope in these youth. And what is suggested in the article is these NCC and NSS cadets, they can be equipped with a thermometer and an oximeter, which checks the levels of oxygen in the body. So each of these volunteers can go to, say, let's say 50 allotted houses per day, and they can go there, which can help in case detection and which can help in the follow-up. And they can act as a bridge between the people who have been home quarantined and who have developed some amount of symptoms and the hospitals and the healthcare system. So in between these volunteers can act as a bridge. So with that help, with this link, even people whose symptoms are getting worsened, they can come to the hospitals. So these youth can act as this link between the people and the hospitals and the healthcare infrastructure. So this is the first thing, voluntary action by mobilizing the youth. That is the first thing as a district collector you do. The next is about the shortages in the skilled healthcare. So definitely in your district, wherever you are a DC, there will be shortage of the skilled healthcare workers like doctors or nurses. So in this case, what can you do? The first thing is that we can request the government to create 1 year short service commission. So short service commission under the National Health Mission, so that the doctors can be recruited who have been freshly graduated. So the recently graduated doctors can be roped in to fight the COVID under the short service commission under the National Health Mission. So that is the first thing. The second thing you can do is that in your district also, there will be several private clinics which would have shut down because of the lockdown. Now they are also facing economic stress, so they also want to open up. So in such cases, the doctors who are practicing in these private clinics can also be roped into fighting the COVID crisis. So these private practitioners can also be roped in. So that is a second strategy that you can adopt. So these strategies will help you have a well-integrated health workforce in your district. The third important thing is the awareness that you will have to raise in your district. So in this case, you will use the mass media to raise awareness, and you will use community leaders to raise awareness, and the local influencers should be used to raise awareness among the masses, whether it is a women's self-help groups or resident welfare associations, even trade unions and business associations. All of these collectives will have to be mobilized so that they can raise awareness among their members, educate them about the do's and don'ts. So these are the three important measures which you can take as a district collector. So we'll move to the next topic, which is issues related to transparency. This issue also we have studied before, we have discussed in detail. So in that regard, what are all the issues related to transparency? The first important issue is the secrecy. So there is a lot of secrecy when it comes to the government functioning, and the government is not willing to open up. So a classic example of this that we have even discussed in the past is the PM CARES Fund. So in the PM CARES Fund, what is happening whenever somebody is applying an RTI application to know the details about the PM CARES Fund, that is not being looked into. So that is being rejected. That is the first thing. The second is that even on the official website of the PM CARES, no information is provided regarding how much amount has been collected, who have all donated, what is the expenditure that is incurred from this fund towards the healthcare or towards the migrants' welfare, whatever it is, where is this spent, from where it is coming, how much is coming, nothing of this information is revealed on the website. The PM CARES is also registered as a trust, so the trust deed of the fund is that also is not available for the in the public for public scrutiny. So therefore, the whole PM CARES is now shrouded in secrecy. Now, because there is a lot of secrecy, accountability is a casualty. So when there is so much of secrecy, it is not possible for the people to hold the government authorities accountable for whatever work they are doing. This is the second issue. Next is the welfare benefits. So when you come to welfare benefits, government has again initiated several programs. For instance, giving free food grains to the poor and the vulnerable during the COVID crisis. But what is very important for the effective delivery of food grains to the people is that information should be available in the public domain about what is the stock of food grains, from which ration shop they can collect there, what is the price of the commodities that are available there, what is the quantity that they are entitled to, and all these information needs to be put in the public domain. But this information again is not being provided in the public domain. So as a result, what is happening is when people are approaching the ration shops asking for food, free food grains, the ration shop owner is telling that there are no stocks, or the ration shop is completely closed and the borders put that there are no stocks. But this is not the case. If the people have information regarding how much stock is now there in each ration shop, then the fair price shop owner cannot cheat people that there are no stocks and therefore they can't be sold food grains. So even in giving welfare benefits to the people also, transparency becomes very much important. Otherwise, the benefits of these welfare schemes don't reach the poor people. So this is another example of how the welfare benefits are not reaching the people during the time of COVID. So these are the issues related to the transparency. So you have specifically in your GS2 syllabus issues related to transparency and accountability. So in that, this you can use. So next is regarding border security. So this is also in your syllabus of GS3. Border security is a specific topic in that syllabus. So here, just a small piece of information that the Indo-Tibetan border police. So Indo-Tibetan border police was actually formed to safeguard our borders with China. So they are now deployed on the India-China border. But in the ITBP now, more than 6,000 positions are laying vacant. So the vacancy has not been filled. So when we are talking about our India-China border issue and the escalation and the standoff between the soldiers, the ITBP vacancy is more than 6,000, which speaks of a laxity when it comes to our approach to border security. So this is very important. It has to be filled on an urgent basis. The vacancies will have to be filled if you want a better and stronger border management and border security. So this you can highlight while you're talking about border security or even the India-China issues related to the border. You can highlight the fact that the ITBP, which is guarding the border, that itself is having so much of vacancies, which will have to be urgently filled. So we'll move on to the next topic. So these are the various articles which were either irrelevant from the exam point of view or were a repetition. So the anti-racism was not relevant. Exam GST was again not relevant. And the undelineated borders and lost in clarifications, they were again related to India-China and there was not much substance in it. Members regarding the working of Rajya Sabha, we have had a question and we have discussed in detail about the relevance of Rajya Sabha in the current context. Then fighting a double pandemic, it was about the COVID pandemic and also the increasing violence on the women, which has seen a rise during the lockdown. So it was that hidden pandemic. So this also we have discussed multiple times before, and India-Nepal ties also is nothing new. Then again, four articles on China, unlike China, time for maturity, playing into China's hands and finding the way forward. So all of these are again a repetition of whatever we have already done. There was one more article on crisis and mobilization. This was by Ashok Gulati, who is an agricultural expert. So this was again whatever was mentioned regarding excess food stocks and we have to liquidate it, and the recent measures taken by the government with respect to Essential Commodities Act and contract farming and the APMC reforms. So all of this is a repetition which we have already covered in detail. So we'll now move on to the next topic, which is use of technology, or you can use it in art and culture topics also. So here, these Kashmiri traditional artisans and the carpet weavers are now planning to sell their produce, sell the carpets through online sale or virtual sale. So a platform will be made through which these artisans will be able to sell their crafts. So this is very important because of the COVID-19 pandemic. The handicrafts and the handloom businesses in the Kashmir were facing very big challenges, and they were unable to sell their products and services to the buyers. So by having this virtual platform or an online sale, it will be a pleasurable experience for both the buyer and the seller also. So now various retailers and even e-commerce businesses are now being called or invited to buy these products of the artisans. So this you can say how technology can be used in first is supporting the traditional artisans by making available to them market which is far and wide also. And you can use in art and culture also, how art and culture can be preserved and it can be encouraged with the help of technology. So in these cases, you can use this as an example. Next is water conservation. So here, the Thane district has bagged this award, the Scotch Award for Water Conservation and Management of Water Bodies at the national level. So Thane district has got the Scotch Award. So the why this is important? The first thing is definitely the water scarcity in India is rising day by day. So therefore, such conservation measures is very important. So when you are quoting, writing your answers on water conservation, which can be a very popular question, so you can quote Thane district and that it got a Scotch Gold Award. So such measures, whatever Thane had taken, that those could be replicated and that should be used, that should be done even across India. That is one application where you can use this as an example while you're writing about water conservation. Second thing is the district collector of Thane district, Pallavi Baldev. So Pallavi Baldev, you can use it as an example of civil servant in and her work in conserving the water in the district, and then how it went on to win the Scotch Award also. So in these two manner, you can use this example. So now what were the interventions that was made? So first is various water bodies that were there in the district were surveyed. So when it was surveyed and a list was made, it was found that there were a lot of encroachments on several of these water bodies. So these encroachments were cleared. Then it was third observed that these water bodies had a lot of silt accumulation, which had reduced the water carrying capacity of these water bodies. So silt removal will have to be done. Then even in the farm ponds can be made so that the farmers have all time availability of water. Then several of these water bodies, illegal sand mining was taking place. So illegal sand mining was again leading to rocky river beds and poor water filtration capacity. So this illegal sand mining was again curbed. And then the green cover was increased. So these were the various steps, including whatever defunct borewells were there, they were rejuvenated. And more emphasis was given on recycling of water also. Recycling and reuse of water. So these were the various interventions that were done in the Thane district, why it went on to win the Scotch Award. So you can mention this as a case study in water conservation question, or you can also highlight the role of the district collector in doing some exceptional work. So next is India-China relations. So here again, one article spoke about a two-front war. So India's Chief of Army Staff General Manoj Mukund has spoke about the fact that India still faces a two-front war. That one is with respect to Pakistan and the other is with China. So India faces a two-front war and its northern border, northwestern border. So, but however, what is being noted in the article is that we have always been obsessed with Pakistan. We always consider that Pakistan is a threat and it can wage a war against India anytime. So this led us to have a very complacent attitude when it comes to China. Because even if you look at the recent standoffs that happened in Debsang, Chumar, now Doklam, they were all diffused and it was our diplomatic success. So then we interacted, our Prime Minister interacted with the President of China, Xi Jinping, also at Wuhan and then at Mamallapuram. So all of this highlighted the high spirits in the relation between India and China, and we always felt that China may not be that aggressive and it cannot escalate things so badly as it has done now. So we always thought that Pakistan is a bigger threat as it can wage any war anytime, but China will not do so. So this has led us to have a very complacent attitude towards China, that China is not going to do us anything. So this is also a repetition of what happened way back in 1960s also, when we had India-China war in 1962. That time, our troop deployment was one Indian soldier to six Chinese soldiers. This was the ratio of our troop deployment that time. So definitely we were found wanting when it comes to the border between India and China. But however, that time also it was believed that China cannot wage a war against India. It cannot start a war against India. So even with this so bad skewed troop deployment also, we believed strongly that China will never fight India over a border issue at least. So this was the assumption. So this assumption per se will have to be changed. So this is the first thing that was good. The second is regarding the strategic goals of China. So now China has done this recent escalation on the border and this soldier standoff and the martyrdom of the Indian soldiers. So all of this has been very tragic. But then whenever we talk about the way forward, how India should respond to the Chinese escalation at the border, then the first and foremost important thing is that for that to be done, we first have to understand why China is doing all this. What are the strategic goals of China, which is pushing it to escalate with us on the border? So in this regard, the first strategic goal of China is that it wants to show that China and India are not the same. So if India is trying to behave in a manner that or see that India and China and the same league, then that is not the case. So China wants India to understand that China is in a different league and India is in a different league. So what we call of the power differential that we were talking the other day, power differential which was spoken of by C. Rajamohan. So this power differential, China wants India to understand this power differential and the fact that China and India cannot be spoken of at the same breath as though they belong to the same league. That is not the case. China is clearly superior and stronger compared to India. This is the point that China wants to drive home in India. That is the first strategic aim. The second is that it wants to give a warning to India. Why? Because India wants to counter China in the region. So it is now aligning with the United States, Japan, Australia. So in order to counter China in the Indo-Pacific region. So by escalating the standoff, escalating the border issues, China wants to give a warning to India that if India is planning these designs by aligning with the US and the allies of US to reduce Chinese dominance in the Indo-Pacific, then that is not going to be seen very nicely by China. So it is also a warning signal. Opposing India's measures to strengthen its ties with US and its allies in order to contain China. So that was a warning by China. This is a second strategic goal of China. The third is that it wants to keep India preoccupied. So India is definitely a growing power in the region. So if it grows well, then it can provide to be an alternative power to China in the Asian region. So China doesn't want India to develop to such an extent. So it wants India to keep India preoccupied in these border issues. So that is another reason why China has escalated this conflict. So if India is preoccupied with the border issues, it will not have time to develop itself as an alternative pole of power to China. That is a next important thing. And fourth strategic goal is that it has always supported Pakistan, even economically as well as militarily. And even it includes the sharing of nuclear weapon designs also, so that India's conventional superiority with respect to Pakistan, that can be neutralized. So China is supporting Pakistan also for this purpose, so that its India's superiority with respect to Pakistan can be neutralized. So these are the four strategic goals of China, which has made it to act the way it has now acted. So why this is important for us to understand the strategic goals is that if we have to formulate a policy on how we are going to react to the Chinese aggressive policies in Ladakh, first and foremost, it is important for us to understand the Chinese strategic goals. So only then we will be able to formulate a response what we have to give to China. So next is there was this article End of Make Believe by C. Rajamohan. The entire article, the crux of the article is that we have to acknowledge the China's rise and the scale of challenge it presents. So that will be the first step in crafting a new China policy. So now that this escalation and all has happened, we have to deliberate and we have to come out with our policy towards China. So how are we going to have our relations with China? So while making this policy, we have to keep in mind regarding China's rise and the scale of the challenge that it can present to us. So if you have a question on the recent India-China escalation standoff and you're writing a way forward, you can simply quote C. Rajamohan and tell that, so according to C. Rajamohan, India should acknowledge China's rise and the scale of challenge that China can present to us, and that will be the first step in our new China policy. So this quoting of the person and this being the first step towards crafting a new China policy, that is very important. Next is securing the sea lanes. So this article was written by Vijay Gokhale, who is a former ambassador to China. So in this article, it was mainly about the Chinese dominance in the maritime region. So the first thing in this is how China's maritime dominance is increasing. The first is that Indian Navy has interdicted some Chinese maritime research and survey vessels in the exclusive economic zone and in the continental shelf. So Chinese research and survey vessels were seen even in our exclusive economic zone and the continental shelf. So this is one thing. And however, for foreign maritime vessels, marine vessels to enter into our EEZ, they need to seek a prior license to undertake these activities. So the Chinese vessels have not taken these license. And also, it is well known fact that China, under the pretext of conducting some scientific research, it sends some vessels which is actually used to collect some crucial oceanographic data which can be used for military purposes. So this it has already done in the South China Sea, and it can do it in the Indian Ocean also. So first of all, the Chinese marine vessels have entered into our EEZ and continental shelf. Secondly, they have not taken any prior license to conduct these activities. And thirdly, China has a track record of using these research vessels to collect some very important crucial oceanographic data which can be used for military purposes. So this is the first issue regarding China's maritime dominance. Second is China already has a base at the Horn of Africa in Djibouti. So China has time and again insisted that this base is just a logistics facility. But now it is beyond doubt, it is clear that it is a military base in the Horn of Africa. So now we, or even for that matter anybody else, won't accept China's claim that it is only a logistics facility. So then other with respect to the Djibouti base, which is a military base for China. Next is now even Cambodia's Riam naval base. So even on this issue is there that Cambodia has given China exclusive access to its Riam naval base. So if that is true, that Cambodia has given China an exclusive access to Riam naval base, then China will be even one step closer to India. So that is the next issue, the Riam naval base. And also next is the plan. Plan is People's Liberation Army Navy. So the Chinese Navy has also been gathering intelligence, and it has sailed through our coastline where it could have gathered information on our naval facilities and ships also. So this has already been done by China, and it can do it in the future also. So this is related to the Chinese maritime dominance. So in this case, what is it that we must do? What is the way forward for us to deal with the Chinese maritime dominance? The first thing is that we have to increase our capacity to monitor our exclusive economic zone and our continental shelf. For this, we need to develop a comprehensive underwater domain awareness strategy. So we need to develop a comprehensive underwater domain awareness strategy that is now missing. So this has to be done. And to develop this underwater domain awareness strategy, we need coordination from the national security agencies, we need cooperation from the Navy and various government departments. So it has to be a coordinated effort to develop an underwater domain awareness strategy. And we also need to collaborate with like-minded countries in the neighborhood, so we can exchange information regarding what is happening in the our oceans, and we can even enter into some co-development for underwater monitoring devices. So we can develop those underwater monitoring devices, and we can process the acoustic signatures in the oceans also together. And the sea lanes will have to be patrolled to see if they are secure. So this patrolling can also be could also be done in a joint manner. So there could be joint patrolling of the sea lanes to ensure that there is freedom of navigation and there is free and open Indo-Pacific. So this is a strategy that we can adopt to counter the Chinese maritime dominance. So next is related to the agriculture sector. It's a small piece of information where Ratan Lal, who is an Indian origin person but is a citizen of United States, has went on to win the World Food Prize. So World Food Prize is equivalent to the Nobel Prize in agriculture. So whenever you're writing any answer on agriculture, so you can quote in the answer, you can make a mention in the answer that this year's World Food Prize winner, Ratan Lal, says that soil is very important. So soil is a living being and it can boost farm output. So he talks about what is called as the law of returns. So law of returns means that this is very important in soil health management, which means whatever you take from land, you must return it to land in some form or the other. So he talks about utilizing the crop residue, which should be returned into back into the soil so that the soil organic content, organic matter is preserved in the top layer. So he gives a lot of importance to the health of the soil, which can boost the agricultural produce. So while you're talking about safe excessive use of fertilizers and all that, you can quote him and say that he says that soil is a living being and it can boost our farm output. So that's it. And then we'll now be discussing yesterday's question. So the question was, what is the importance of mental health and analyze the government measures taken to improve mental health? So in this regard, first you will be defining the mental health. You can use the WHO definition of mental health, which talks about the well-being of oneself so that one is able to lead a balanced life. There will be increased productivity at the workplace, and there will also be harmony in the social relations. So this is a definition of WHO for mental health. So this with this definition, you can directly come to the importance of mental health. So in the importance of mental health also, you can see how it is important for an individual, because the thoughts, behaviors, emotions, they are all linked. So how it could otherwise lead to suicide tendencies and depression. So that is why it is important. Then a good mental health will promote productivity and effectiveness in whatever activities we do. And if you are mentally sound, it will also improve the health of our relationships. So social also, it is good. And if you look at the scenario today, WHO report says that nearly 7.5% of the Indian population suffers from some form or the other of mental disorder. And WHO also projects that by 2020, roughly 20% of India's population will be suffering from mental illness. So this is the severity of the problem, and that makes mental health all the more important. So with describing 3 to 4 arguments for importance, you can directly come to the measures taken by the government and their analysis. So in the importance, you can also tell how the stigma is associated with mental illness. So that is also another reason why mental health is very important, to remove the stigma also. So when it comes to the measures that the government has taken several measures like the Mental Health Care Act that was enacted in 2017. Then there was something called as Satyam. Satyam is science and technology for yoga and meditation. So this was to strengthen research in yoga and meditation, and which could be a solution to our physical and mental health problems. Apart from this, we have the National Mental Health Program, which was started in 1982 itself. Then we have a District Mental Health Program. And we have other initiatives like WHO's Comprehensive Mental Health Mental Action Plan that spans from 2013 to 2020, of which India is also a part. Then our Sustainable Development Goals, which we intend to progress in this regard also. So all of these are the various measures that the government has taken. So next, you will have to try to analyze various measures that the government has taken. So when you come to the analysis, the first thing you can say is हाँ, बिफोर दैट हियर यू कैन अडॉप्ट टू स्ट्रैटेजी. वन इज यू कैन लिस्ट आउट द गवर्नमेंट मेजर्स दैट हैज बीन टेकन वन बाय वन, एंड एट द एंड यू कैन लिस्ट आउट एन एनालिसिस ऑफ दीज वेरियस मेजर्स दैट द गवर्नमेंट हैज टेकन, और यू कैन एनालाइज द इंडिविजुअल मेजर्स टेकन बाय द गवर्नमेंट. बट फॉर दैट यू हैव टू नो थिंग्स इन ग्रेट डिटेल. फॉर इंस्टेंस, इफ यू डोंट नो सत्यम, इफ यू डोंट नो हाउ इट हैज फंक्शनड, देन यू विल नॉट बी एबल टू एनालाइज इट. So though you can write a generic thing that it has not performed to the extent and all, but you won't know any specific things. So I advise that rather than writing issue-wise analysis, write the steps taken by the government and then make an analysis of the overall steps that the government has taken in all these decades. So those issues will still remain, on which basis you can write your way forward. So when it comes to the measures, analysis of the measures, so for instance, under the Mental Health Care Act, suicide has been decriminalized so that the stigma is not there. But still, even today, stigma is there around people who try to attempt suicide, that they are mentally weak or something. So all these stigma is still there. And we spoke of Satyam. Satyam is about propagating yoga and meditation so that people have that mental relaxation. But yoga again is seen from religious angle and not everybody wants to practice yoga. And also, if you look at the policies or the Mental Health Care Act also, more focus is on the curative aspect and not on the preventive aspect. And fourth issue is regarding the financial allocation. So nearly in the 1.2% of something of our GDP, which is being spent on the health, of this only 0.6% is being spent on the mental health. So this shows how poor resource allocation has been done to such an important thing as the mental health. Next issue is the presence of the mental health care services is also very skewed. It is more concentrated in the urban areas while it is not there in the rural areas. It is absent in the rural areas. Another issue is that when it comes to mental health, there are several vulnerable categories which can be targeted specifically, like farmers, women, youth, students. So these are some of the vulnerable categories, but we don't have any such policy whereby these vulnerable categories are given more attention to and they are specifically targeted. So that is again not there. Then another issue comes is that there is a post-treatment gap. Once a person who is suffering from some one or the other mental illness is given a treatment, after the treatment, the most important thing is a proper rehabilitation after the treatment. So focus is not there on this rehabilitation post-treatment, but rather the focus is only on treatment. So this is another thing. Next is you can talk about the pathetic conditions of the mental health care institutions or hospitals where patients are seen sitting on their own urine. So they urinate on their beds and they are just sitting there. Patients are nude. Sexual abuse is done on these mentally ill patients. Then they are kept in such unhygienic conditions. Even when the Mental Health Act says that handcuffing should not be there, still they are kept handcuffed. So all of these things shows the pathetic conditions of the mental health hospitals, which needs to be improved. Then another thing is that these mental health issues, they tend to increase or exacerbate during the times of economic downturn. So that is when most people are hit economically, they have lost their livelihoods. So that is when the mental stress and anxiety will be more. But we don't have policies which are focused more towards these important sectors like mental health during the time of economic distress or any such vulnerable times. So that is also not matched. And then you can say the mental health specialists, the professionals, psychologists, psychiatrists, they are also very, very short in number. So because of this, the care is cannot be provided to the needy people who are mentally ill and who need some form of treatment. So then you can write your way forward, where you can mention what has to be done in the future. We can train the grassroots functionaries like the ASHAs and ANMs so that they are able to detect and provide some treatment for common mental health disorders. That can be done. And then counseling can be done through telemedicine using the digital intervention. That counseling can be done. Then also The role of religion and the peer groups is very important. So we can popularize yoga, relaxation exercises, meditation, and even prayer. So that will have a lot of soothing effect and calms down our anxiety levels. Then we can give example of say Deepika Padukone's Live, Love, Laugh Foundation, which is an NGO, and through it, the role of NGOs can be highlighted to reduce stigma and to improve awareness about the mental health illness across the country. And we also need to increase our specialists in the healthcare sector. And as we saw yesterday, how the Sangat model, where it has collaborated with the community healthcare providers, and they will be intervening and providing solutions to the local level mental health issues. So all these things can be. Now, today's question is, discuss the severity of water crisis in India, suggest measures to conserve water. It's a 10-mark question for 150 words. And that's it for today. And the next video, I won't be able to post tomorrow as I'm again traveling. I'll be posting the next video on Friday. So this week, it will be like two days newspaper on the third day. So Wednesday and Thursday's news will be covered on Friday morning. So that's it for today. Thank you.